thank you so much for asking me back here. I had the very great pleasure of reading here in a duet with Helen Tookie when the gallery reopened a few years ago. This first poem is inspired by the field postcards which were sent during the First World War. I don't know whether you've seen any of these, but if you go onto the Imperial War Museum website, there's a good example. Basically, there'd be a series of options, and you have to cross out the ones that didn't apply, such as, you know, have received a parcel, am expecting a parcel, that sort of thing. You couldn't add anything else. You could just cross out options, otherwise your postcard would not be sent. I was living in a flat at the time where everyone except me saw the ghosts of soldiers. I wasn't very good at seeing them. So I decided to do some research, and I found out that just up the road, there had been a recruiting station in the First World War, and one of the people associated with it then became a pilot who died in a crash in April 1918. So I wrote this poem for him. Field postcard. Nothing is to be written on this side except the date and signature of the sender. Sentences not required may be erased. If anything else is added, the postcard will be destroyed. So curry marigolds, show sorrow, hide July war in flowers at home, their code is tender. Nothing is to be written on this side except the date and signature of the sender. April he fell in flames, lilies of the valley implied humility, poppies oblivion, tender your papers. No letter lately wounded, no parcel well erased, apple blossom admitted, rose follows, iris destroyed. Nothing is to be written on this side except the date and signature of the sender. Sentences not required may be erased. If anything else is added, the postcard will be destroyed. The next set of poems were based on a series of tours which poets offered freely in the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford. We'd pick an object which spoke to us for some reason, write something about it, and then we'd go from object to object on a poetry route, and the members of the public were free to join us or not if they wished. There's a copy of a statue of Zeus, which people had been dissing for just being a copy, but then thought how remarkable it was to be able to copy such a statue. Saying yes to Zeus. Tall Zeus, forgive the mean aspect of this standard and static depiction your admirers should find problematic. Squared off toenails, small ears, some parts one shan't mention. For you hold the lightning bolt, but you don't. Even that is gone from this bronze copy. All seeing Zeus, overlook how we come close. Your frown, your sinews, your ankles resemble the elderly athlete the museum claims this figure might be. You love mortality. Dear Zeus, our clouded heads forgot. The copy and the copier, sportsman, model, statue maker, are your originals. Through you we move, through us you move. Lord of lightning, spinal fire that sexes the brain, nuclear waste. A great many feathers puncture my breast from within, and ridding myself of them, finding I cannot free myself, they vault outwards. Like everything, I am in your grasp and also flying. It strikes me, you are sometimes kind. The next poem is inspired by an excellent 18th century lass, which was considered too boring to be on display and is unfortunately no longer on display. I was fascinated by it. Through and through. L'attimo. L'attimo. Milk, twist, mist, hint. Venetians, pearled minerals. Lead lime, tin lime, thicked clear glass to quasi Chinese porcelain for simple painting, birds and flowers. Fingers twirl composite stems whose color twist rock candies, slate ladders, precious yellow, less rare green, bird flower red, while blue, longed for, yearns like a certainty expressed by convolution. But inwardly a wind of truth. Contemplate for a moment, l'attimo, how just as when in calmo joins bubbles blown separately, two while hot made one, each listed item here desires liquid lips, lights prompted below looped eyes. Ekphrastic poetry can also be ekphrasis of a building. And there's a building or set of buildings in Port of Spain in Trinidad called Alice Yard, after the woman whose house it was, which are now used as artist studios. And during the 2011 curfew, which was imposed there, because it was neither a private nor a public space, we were able to hold a curfew-breaking event and read poetry outdoors. Gift of a staircase for Alice Yard. For the sake of clarity, which is the black-out, whale-back, salient and misguiding aspect of what I now hope to essay, I desire of you to accept of me this staircase. I desire it for you in the diminishing of every association of staircase with birdcage. I desire you attentive to the unpicking of your own ribcage. I desire you vertiginous if you rise, if you walk, if you remain. I desire with you ascent. Shaking off my old horrific procedure of careful omissions, I would have burnt down the house, except it fell upon itself, except it fell of itself, except I too needed to escape, and did nothing, and yet could not put myself out of the way of burning. You had begun the escape. Why did I skirt the burning? We too may have escaped. What of the pervasive sensation of another burning? I am sensible of every blade of grass invisible by distance blocks away on lawns, far green and purple crisped to a solar fury of worms. A surging somewhere, chromosomal, curlicues, unamendable. The destruction we both do and do not witness. Looms sky high and therefore appears entire and objective. So do we. So we do. But for me, this aspect, our doing, for there is this thing I now hope to assay. I desire in yours my own ascent. In this blue, blue sky used to reel a glory of vultures. What picked them off? This is not a harp plundered along the journey of a grand piano's innards. This is not a mushroom's undercap wealth of soft, dark spines. Oh yes, there is a family resemblance to the impressive wickerwork hand-plaited by our blind ones. But I've not brought you the gift of a chair. Accept of me this staircase. And that I too yearn skywards in the manifold increase of simplicity for which there is another name. And that we look up hotly. Oh, you are lifted from me. And about that which I left, unburnt. I was asked to do a bit of writing about Shakespeare, the South Bank Centre for Radical Shakespeare, and it struck me that there was this lane in King Lear where Edmund had cut himself to get attention. And he says, "Look, sir, I bleed." And all his father can say is, "Where's the villain? Where's the villain, Edmund?" Which strikes me as a completely inadequate parental response. He's there, literally bleeding, but all his father wants to do is pursue an academic formulation of justice. "Look, sir, I bleed." You're asking, "Where's the villain?" "Look, I bleed." When men bleed, they shouldn't. Men bleed when they shouldn't. There are too many women in this play, all of an age to bleed. None more children. Lunar and silent, they have spread a field of blood beneath the action. Dirt has skirts, smooth roads rust, tiled surfaces tainted with vinegar. Nothing wipes nothing out, nothing can be reached directly, nothing that does not shed a lining, shudder, rubbish the chance to make one clean, sweet, queen bee line. "Look, sir, the whole tree of myself blushes for your attention, came into flowering and was cut down, flowered again, cut down again, not by a blade or breeze. The natural result of inattention, yours." The sea breaks its allotted surface and self-harms, changing where it goes, what can live inside it. "You'll buy me a new shirt, hire people to wipe up after me. I want their job, want my blood on my hands and in your eyes." I was asked by English Pen to write some responses to what was happening in Syria, and more particularly the disappearance of the violent abduction of the Duma 4, who were engaged in documenting violence perpetrated by persons on any other side, and I started having a series of dreams. Interventions around the city. This ritual is not intended to cleanse. This ritual is to wash away the ritual. The removal of the roofs is intended to restore a sense of the original roofs. The grandeur of the buildings which were wiped out may be reconceivable by the sky's grandeur, to return it to sand. How can you say that? Of course you didn't, when it was not raised from sand. To repair it with open water courses, where was water's deeper hiding place from burning air? To plant it with orchards, how can you plan that? What grows? A foreign-owned desalination plant? The veins of this earth are baked with alphabets. View strikes as vascular surgery on flaked earth. I'm wondering if we can sing more cheerful. Does it have to be cheerful when you assumed you see a cake? The British Council and the International Literature Showcase kindly asked me to write on the theme of crossing borders. And I was thinking of some of the borders which are not the ones policed by passports or walls, visible or invisible. But for example, the border between where you think yourself begins and the edge of your clothing ends, or the border between where one room ends and another begins, particularly where there's no door. And I started thinking of that sort of thing. And then I started thinking of borders between bodies, not in the ordinary way of sex or birth, but in activities like martial arts. To be born is to be brought to the light. But do not wish her feliz cumpleaños. Do not tell her either that I let you know that in the Spanish Civil War they shot her father, like most of the villagers. Did they trespass, or were they pushed into the realm of the no longer mortal, hence unforgettable? The shot was fired on her birthday. You must remember that. She remembers the date of her brilliant light in the blaze of death. Anyway, you're not supposed to know when a nun's birthday falls. Because they're married to Christ and lose their names and choose a name. Yes, I think they get to choose. Why does she always wear nun shoes? It is part of her habit. It would be out of order for her to dress otherwise, being in an order that wears blue and white and travels overseas. She has desired to go on an awfully big adventure. The thing is, when one of the men said that martial arts class was nothing but thwarted sexuality, and another of the men disagreed because fighting is erotic and theoretically homosocial, you could not say a thing. You could not explain how you have not been in your own skin when you were skin on skin with another human being and indeed had your heads in each other's crotches when stretching after the warm-up and before sparring. You could not tell him that you do not pause to savor skin on skin or even feel the heat of the other person, because having been transformed into a thing that acts as soon as thinks leaves no way back into the experience that lets you out back again to explain. When the white costume is in motion with such a clean line that it cracks so you hear it, you know from the sound, like a sound effect, there is action that is going right, but you cannot see the film. And this is not acting. When you advance the edge of your arm so the sharp bone locks, it may cause both hurt, but causes none pain. When you become 2 meters of direction and 2 knuckles of surface, you are concentrated. You may be in contact, you are not in touch. It is going through. You are the mass and machine through which it goes, through when the white costumes are in motion. Damn you, I said in my head, but also affectionately. I am not speaking of or as myself or for anyone. When I try to think feelingly into the girls who wear veils, when you said to me, outward show, not at all affectionately, you were not speaking of my wearing white as a token for mourning. You were thinking that clothing is put on and put off, is separate from body and body is separate from spirit. But my everyday is a being in of being, a mixity of worlds. You were deciding that I had choice and had made a fashion choice. That colour had not run out of my life, such that anciently and in other ugly adverbs and untranslatable ways, my body was temporarily and cross-temporally beyond being dressed or mine, but was one of all those who were ever like me in mourning. And if you could have cut me through like a crystal, the truth of my insides would have been colourless too, though you might have decided to fail to see that clarity, and instead reinvent my lungs and my guts to decipher as crassness, at which point my ichor and shit would have been your illusion. There is, too, the amulet, prayed over in front of a thousand name chanted fire by another dead one. It was like poking my eye or bruising my clit when the airport guard stared me down and fingered it as if to pretend it might be a poison capsule or travestied radical souvenir bullet. I felt it hold up my nerves when she grabbed the gold cylinder. The metal hung in air, clasped externally, yet more internal to me. So, take it off is not an option. Without trying, thinking feelingly, I am not speaking of or as myself or for any one. Down the subtle body's extension into material, effectively. Now, I know I've read this poem in Manchester not that long ago, but I want to read it again because, I'm sorry if some of you have heard it, and it's from Sidekick Books anthology, which responds to Catullus. And when I was asked to write this, I thought, well, some really famous poet, and probably some man, will take all the good ones, and is feeling really chased off. And then I thought, no, what you have to do is go straight onto the Excel sheet and stick all the good ones after your own name, take them first. And to anyone who was in the workshop, I strongly advise that. Take the good ones first. Do not sit there fuming. After Catullus 5, you know, there's the famous one where he comes up all the kisses that he wanted to give Lesbia, and then says, and then erase them back within ourselves so that jealous people won't know how many. I was thinking, what it would be like to be Lesbia with this person saying, yeah, 100, 101, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, yeah. You know, somebody who's counting. Was it time, Catullus, I'd indulge your counting fetish? Relay how long a pause and need, ascending stairs to bed, squidge, wipe, repeat. Sensations fragile to my declining body, switched on hypersensitivities to linen thread, count, not to say stone, till skin inclined to flinch from sucking discs, remora-like, which swarm from any contact, every surface. You write when you cross, sharp silk, you a cultured man, dressing made to measure, rubbing those bronze balls on your abacus, spittle kissing mercury on your practice mirror. As for me, I'm lying open, beautifully open, to a tease of a beautician's innumerable tweezings, laughing with the blonde from Gallia, who lays her head low on my belly while she tends my lady garden. I think I have time for just one more, isn't it? Just reading for 20 minutes. And I don't know whether I want to go on reading body ones with not a particularly embodied person, I say, standing in front of you. Simple complex shapes, aka the one with the goats on it, is the cheapest of the books that I've brought out there. It contains some little poems and calligrams, which I never read because they're unreadable, they make shapes, like sails and umbrellas. Who's sending you on this mission? Tell her a story to end today, in which she does not feature, in which she will be the character heard singing in the woods, in which she is that character. And since the men swarmed off, smoke nonetheless has been witnessed rising from over the site of the old forge. Make her part of the story only if she lives far from the woods and cannot walk alone, if her beheaded people have moved outside books, if weapons are mythopoetic, self-funding. In my house, falling through the floor of myself, falling from falling in a father's house, from the double attic where wasps nested, cemented to beams, rosettes, buttonholes, rugby balls, falling through ceiling, floor, I cannot remember how much further there is, how this house, suffering from subsidence, presents so many flaws. I am solitaire, and the pack reshuffled to make a paper house, and the ground recanting, tilted atop a watercourse. This was our house, a roof tree, the tails roosting and hospitable. There the sky signs, who is missing? I take the sun. Rain is falling gently on a sloping roof. How am I to stay awake? Leopard cats petition for their morning meats. Piteous, round-mouthed. Look for them till you no longer look at them. Bright sky. They could not make a home with you, nor wait at home for you. Always they go home in you. Every happy solitude. Thank you so much.